O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on a cross my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you. bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, our needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God. Trials and temptations, is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord. Find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrows share.
Welcome, friends. We'll get started in a minute. Thanks for joining us again. Sunny and Julie, if you have problems with the internet, you might move your computer closer to your router. I think we talked about that last week. But if you have problems, move the laptop closer to the router this time. See if that helps, okay?
Okay.
Welcome back. As usual, we're going to get started with some worship. So, in order for us to worship again, it works best if we mute ourselves. So make sure to mute your mic, and the words will be on the screen. We'll worship together, and then we'll start a little bit after that, okay? Let me go ahead and share screen.
Away.
Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we invite your presence to be with us as we join together. Thank you for this time that we've carved out for each person who's here and the sacrifices they've made to enter into this space and to look at your scripture. God, you only know what we carry into this time. You know the burdens that we carry. You know the joys we've had this week. Now we bring all those things to you, Lord, and we ask that as we enter into this communal study of scripture, that you would speak to us. Your word is living, Lord, and we know that there's a lot that we can get from it, but we pray that as we try to understand it, that it would be like living water for our souls, that it would go into the places that are parched, that it would go into the places that are dry and thirsty, and that it would quench us. Thanks for each and every person who's here on this call this evening. Jesus, would you bless our time together? Amen. Welcome again. Thanks all for joining. Back again, we are at our second to last study in the book of Ruth. And tonight is an exciting one. It's we're getting into an interesting part of the passage, probably a section of the scripture of the book of Ruth that not a lot of people look at, but we will look at it this evening. The section that we're looking at is from, well, let me actually, before we do that, let me paste the Google Doc into, if you have the link from the email that I sent, go ahead and open that up. Otherwise, I'll just paste the link here in the chat box. There you go. So you should be able to open that up. That's the Google Doc that we'll be using today. It's the same one we always use. And we'll be looking at page 5, line 16, where we ended last week. We ended with the word mother-in-law. So we're starting with the word Naomi on page 5, line 16. And then we're going to go all the way through to page 7, line 9. Page 7, line 9. And it's going to end with the phrase, settle the matter today. So right after the word today, which is the end of that line, you can just put a mark there. That's the section that we'll be looking at this evening. Are we all on the same page? Thumbs up, yeah, good. All right, so be it. Let me read the scripture. And as you're hearing it, just jot down if you notice things, observations, things that stand out to you, go ahead and jot those things down. We'll also take some personal time after that, but let me read the scripture. This is page 5, line 16. Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, I need to seek some security for you so that it might may be well with you. Now here is our kinsman Boaz, with whose young women you have been working. See, he's winnowing barley tonight at the threshing floor. Now wash and anoint yourself and put on your best clothes and go down to the threshing floor. But do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, observe the place where he lies. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down, and he will tell you what to do." She said to her, "All that you tell me, I will do." So she went down to the threshing floor and did just as her mother-in-law had instructed her. When Boaz had eaten and drunk, and he was in a contented mood, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain. Then she came stealthily and uncovered his feet and lay down. At midnight, the man was startled and turned over, and there, lying at his feet, was a woman. He said, "Who are you?" And she answered, "I am Ruth, your servant. Spread your cloak over your servant, for you are next of kin." He said, "May you be blessed by the Lord, my daughter. This last instance of your loyalty is better than the first. You have not gone after young men, whether poor or rich. And now, my daughter, do not be afraid. I will do for you all that you ask, for all the assembly of people know that you are a worthy woman. But now, though it is true that I am a near kinsman, there is another kinsman more closely related than I. Remain this night, and in the morning, if he will act as next of kin for you, good, let him do it. If he's not willing to act as next of kin for you, then as the Lord lives, I will act as next of kin for you. Lie down until the morning. So she lay at his feet until morning, but got up before one person could recognize another. For he said, it must not be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. Then he said, bring the cloak you are wearing and hold it out. So she held it out. And he measured about 6 measures of barley and put it on her back. Then he went into the city. She came to her mother-in-law, who said, how did things go with you, my daughter? Then she told her all that the man had done for her, saying, he gave me these 6 measures of barley. For he said, do not go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed. She replied, wait, my daughter, until you learn how the matter turns out. For the man will not rest, but will settle the matter today. Okay, let's take about 5 to 10 minutes. I'll judge based on how I'm seeing our responses, but about 5 to 10 minutes in personal time, and note observations. What are the things that stand out to you? And if there's a question, put a different color and write that question out in the margins. We will come back and share together. Okay, let's go.
Thank you.
Okay, let's come back together. We're gonna get some time in breakout groups to share a little bit about what we saw and share our questions. Before we do that, I want to just highlight one quick thing that might help us in understanding and interpreting this passage. And that's the word goel. So if you saw the email that I sent this weekend or yesterday or 2 days ago, it had all the background information on about Ruth and specifically the Hebrew word goel. That word it's sometimes translated into the English as redeem. And it literally means the act of a kinsman or the act of a family member to redeem the family name. So of course you can read more about that on the background sheet that I sent you. But Bob had done a little work and looked up the where that word goel appears in the text. Bob, would you mind just letting us know where that shows up before we go into breakout groups?
Yeah, it doesn't. There is one use of the word kinmen on page 5, but that is not interpreted goel.
Okay.
So it's not until page 6, line 11. the word, the beginning of the line there, line 11, you are next to kin.
So that's goel right there. So what are you on page 6, line 11, right above the word next of kin, you could write above it the Hebrew word goel, okay? And then again, where does it appear?
Yeah, this is all page 6, okay? So page 6, and then we would go to line 16. Am a near kinsman, that's goel.
Okay.
And then on the same line, another kinsman, it's goel, kafar, me, ani. So it's goel with some other Hebrew words.
Yeah,
that means it's nearer, you know, but the goel is there too.
Yep.
And then further down, we're down, let's see, 15, 16, 17, 18. What's later on, it says, if he's not willing to act as a next of kin, that would be goel there.
Okay.
And then the next line, which would be 19, as the Lord lives, I will act as goel for you. I think that's it in the passage that we have today.
Good. Excellent. Thank you, Bob. Okay, so what we're gonna do in our breakout times, I've given you about 8 minutes in your breakout groups. If you haven't introduced yourself, please introduce yourself briefly. Share one or two observations that stood out to you, and then a question. And I know some of you have been writing in the chart already, that's excellent. There is a table for observations, and below it, there's a table for questions. I would love for all of us to put our observations and our questions in there. I know some of you cannot access the Google Doc because you're calling from your phone. So if that's the case, just share your question, your observation with the person in your group and ask them to put it into the table, okay? Look for the button that's gonna invite you to the breakout room now. Do you see it, Annabelle? Sunny, do you see it? You're muted. Erna, you're muted. Could you guys both unmute yourself? Okay. What's wrong, Maisie?
Hey, Jerome. I don't have anyone in my breakout room.
You know what? You guys just work right here together. That's okay.
Okay.
So work with Erna.
Hi, Erna.
Hi. I'm sorry. I got disconnected. I just came back.
No problem. You're good.
Oh, okay.
Sunny's here also, but they're frozen, so I'm hoping they'll come back at some point. But go ahead and get started.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll be back.
Okay, cool. Sounds good. Hi, Erna.
Hi, Macy.
What did you see in the passage today?
Well, I see the humility and modesty of Ruth, knowing that she needs, you know, the mom wants her to have a security. She could have gone to Boaz and, you know, dressed up and smelling good, but she laid down on his feet instead of next to him. She did not herself to him.
Yeah.
That's what my observation.
Cool. Yeah. I think I saw someone else said the same thing, or he might have put it down in the Google Doc. I think what I noticed was, I think I was caught by Boaz's reaction to her.
Mm-hmm.
So he says, like, a couple things about how this instance of your loyalty is better than the first. Yeah. And then he also says in line 14, for all the assembly of my people, know that you are a worthy woman. I thought that was interesting because I think earlier in the passage too, like she has this reputation of like people know her by her loyalty to her mother-in-law. Mm-hmm. And so I think that was, I think it's really interesting. I think what it says to me is that reputation is kind of important, or it was important to kind of the dynamics of, the relationship.
Yeah. Right. He respected her. It shows mm-hmm. how
right.
respect.
Right.
Respect.
Yeah. Her. Yeah. That's a good point. I think I'm really curious though about what it means when it says, like, when he says this last instance of your loyalty is better than the first. Mm-hmm. I think it's a very I wonder what that means. She's obviously demonstrating loyalty to him, mm-hmm. but like, why is that better than just being loyal to Naomi?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's a good question for a question, huh? What he meant mm-hmm. first loyalty. Your loyalty now is better than the first. I think that's a good question.
Yeah. Okay. I will put that down. Hi. What?
We are.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if you guys were in a group earlier, but you guys are here and you can be in our group.
Number two. I think.
Oh yeah, I was in two or three or something like that. No one was there, so I came here.
But I got disconnected.
We got lost.
We got kicked out, and then when we came back, we ended up. In
this I did too.
Oh, okay. So maybe this is the original group.
Anyway, let's see. I was listening to what you were saying. Well, I didn't know what Ruth did to be blessed by Boaz. That saying that which is better, the last instance is better than. What did she do to that Boaz blessed her about her last instance of loyalty, better than the first? I don't know what she did. Did she do to be?
I think she is demonstrating some sort of loyalty, right, to Boaz, and somehow this is very significant. But
what was the significance? What was its significance?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, that was my question.
Okay.
Maybe we'll ask Jerome.
May I notice?
Yeah.
I noticed Naomi's concern with Ruth, what she said on page 5, line 17, that I need to seek some security for you. So she's concerned for her future. That is page 5, line 17. So that was nice of her to be concerned for Ruth's future.
Yeah.
That was my biggest observation. As much as she needed to seek security
for Ruth,
you know, Ruth was still humble in that, just, you know, flaunting herself or.
Well, because Ruth
did herself decide, to Boaz.
Well, Ruth did not decide to leave her. She's stuck with her, so maybe it's payback time.
Yeah.
But it is for her own good.
That's what I'm saying.
For her future.
Because Ruth didn't leave Naomi alone.
Yeah. Well, that's nice of her, for Naomi to be concerned for Ruth's future. To try and find her a husband, per se.
Rigid. To Naomi's instructions, that she did everything that Naomi told her.
Yeah, to the
Yeah. And I wonder if, at first, my first interpretation of like this last instance of loyalty is better than the first. I first thought it was loyalty to Boaz, but do you think it might mean loyalty to Naomi?
I think so.
Maybe she's, yeah, because like what you guys are saying.
How did Boaz know that she followed her instruction? Maybe it's their custom, it's their tradition, and it's not roots. How did Boaz know that you were following Naomi's instruction? Because all she did is their tradition.
Okay. All right, so let's do this. We shared a lot of observations. What I want us to do is go to the Google Doc. It's in the chat box. You can click the link there. And I want us to look at the observations. There's a lot of great observations in the table. Look at the observations of people from other groups and just read the things that stood out to you, or stood out to them rather. It's great. You know, one of the downsides to doing this study in this kind of virtual space is that we don't get to hear everything. Normally when I lead a study like this, we get to hear everybody's observations, but I encourage you to go to the table, read some of those observations. One observation, for example, Annabelle noted from her group that kinsmen is a very important thing in their culture. And that's very true. Like this, it seems like as you read this text, kinsmen or goel gets repeated multiple times. And so that's something that needs to be taken seriously, that seems to be taken seriously in that culture. Another observation that stood out to me, Joseph had commented that Ruth is very obedient. Naomi just says, hey, I want you to look out for your security. And she just goes and does everything that Naomi asked her. So there's a lot of great observations that we noted there. Let's actually get into the text now. So if you can, put pages 5, 6, and 7 right in front of you, because we can, that way we'll be able to look at the whole thing and make any connections that we might have there. I see a total of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 questions. So I'm gonna address those questions. If there's any other last questions in there, please add them in, and I'll make sure that we try to make some space. But it looks like a lot of our questions center in on page 6. There's a lot going on in page 6, and there's a lot of, there's a lot of cultural stuff that doesn't seem to make sense. So first off, the story starts off with Naomi telling Ruth, I need to seek some security for you so that it may be well for you. And so she says that Boaz is winnowing barley. Does anybody know what that means, to be winnowing barley? Does anybody have any background information on that they could share?
No, I don't know what it means.
You don't know what it means? Okay, who knows what they mean?
You know?
Isn't it like blowing barley?
I don't know, yes.
Yeah. Wind, because winnowing is wind. It's a blowing of, to remove something from the grain.
Okay.
Remove chaff from the grain.
Yeah, that's to remove chaff from the grain. They sort of the wind blows through.
When wind blow.
Anybody else have any other information?
Not on that, but before we move beyond this, this statement that she says, I need to seek some security.
Yes.
It's echoed, this is an echo of it from page 1, lines 17 and 18, when the two daughter-in-laws, this is after the sons have died, and the two daughter-in-laws are starting to travel with her, but then she's like, no, you need to go back to your families, because I want you to have rest, is one interpretation, or seek security for you. It's actually the same phrase.
Okay.
So she has had this concern for her daughter-in-laws back before this instance. And I think she figures that her other daughter-in-law has taken care of it, has found that security in her family in Moab, but she still has that concern for Ruth. So it's a long-standing concern of hers.
Yep. So what repetition of word security on page 1, line 18. And that's a significant one. Naomi's consistent in her desire to seek security for Ruth. It's good. Good. So that's what's motivating Naomi and saying Ruth. So winnowing, anything else we want to add about winnowing that you guys know about? I think we, Julie said a lot about it. It's like, it's trying to separate the chaff from the grain. Anything else that's helpful for us to know? I mean, maybe the only other piece of information that would be helpful for us is that winnowing was done in a communal space. So it's not like somebody just does this in their backyard, but at the end of the harvest, all the farmers gather together and they go to the threshing floor. And there's a period of time when the winnowing happens where they're working to separate the chaff from the grain, and it's done with the wind and shaking the grain and all of that stuff. But it's a communal experience. So it is sort of the beginning of the celebration of the harvest. It's still part of the work of the harvest, but it's sort of the tail end of the work of the harvest, this separating the grain from the chaff. So Naomi knows that the winnowing is happening at the threshing floor, and she sends Ruth to get her security there. And she has these very specific instructions. The instructions are go there, put on your best clothes, and don't make yourself known until after he's eaten, then lie down to the place where he lies and go uncover his feet. Now, we had a question here. Let me just find it.
What kind of tradition is that?
I'm sorry, can you say that again, Joseph?
No, I'm thinking, what kind of tradition is that, lying down at the end of the feet?
Yeah, we're gonna get to that.
Okay. So, all right, thank you, sorry.
No, you're good. I'm just looking at that. So that's, what is the significance of that? So Eddie asked this question. It's the same question that Sunny's asking. What's the significance of asking Ruth to lie at Boaz's feet? So let's just talk about that. And remember, push space bar to unmute yourself.
My first thought is that it's a way of her offering herself to him.
Okay. Any other thoughts?
Could it be like she's a servant, so she's telling Boaz or whoever you lie on the feet that you're below them and that they're like your master?
Okay. So do you see that, Irene, as something separate from what Bob said? So Bob was saying she's offering herself. You're saying that she's putting herself in the position of a servant. Do you see that as going hand in hand with what with Bob's saying, or as a separate option?
I think it's a separate option because she's not offering herself as his wife.
Okay.
She's just offering herself as a servant. I don't think she knows that the answer to that is that he was going to take her as his wife.
Okay.
It's just more that she's there to be of service to him.
Yeah. And
because she's not in that. I don't think she was trying to attract him or anything like that.
Okay. Yeah. So let me clarify, Bob, when you said she's offering herself, did you mean offering herself as a wife?
Well, as a woman, let me say it that way.
Okay. So sexually.
Seems to me that she's making herself available to him.
Okay.
Because it's the middle of the night.
Yep.
If she wanted to do anything like I could be your servant or whatever, she would have done it in the middle of the day, right? This is the middle of the night. She's waiting till he's like drunk, not drunk. I mean, that he's content and she wants to lie next to him, but she doesn't want him to know that she's lying next to him until she's already lied next to him. I mean, she's putting herself, in my eyes, she's putting herself in a very compromising position, and she's doing it intentionally.
Okay. Now, just to make a statement, because this is where culturally we could superimpose things. In our American 21st century culture, we separate marriage from sexual relations, right? That is an American paradigm. In this particular Hebraic ancient society, those things would not have been separated. So so what we're having here is two options. Bob is saying that Ruth is offering, Naomi's telling Ruth, offer yourself as a wife, offer yourself as a sexual partner to Boaz. And what Irene is saying is that Naomi's telling Ruth, offer yourself as a servant. Those are two distinct options. And I love that we have two distinct options. Let's hear from some others. I'm going to call on Kevin. Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead, Kevin.
I think I know that I can see where it says in the text, like, I am Ruth, your servant. But it also says, like, spread your cloak over your servant, for you are next of kin. So I think, like, when she uses the word next of kin, it's the word goel. And she's basically giving him the invitation to be the kinsman redeemer, which he's fully aware of. And I think, I just think it's interesting that she uncovered him, and then she asked for him to cover her. Mm. And I wonder if that's like, I don't know, I don't have any, I can't reference anything outside of this that I can think of I feel like this is like a Jewish kind of, like, tradition.
Okay.
But I can't think of any examples right now, like a symbolic gesture, I guess, if you would say.
Well, at the very least, the thing that you're saying, Kevin, is that you're pointing to the phrase on line 11 where Ruth says, you are next of kin. So in stating that she's you are next of kin, you're saying that that's evidence to the fact that she's offering herself as a wife or as a sexual partner to Boaz. Other folks, do you agree? Do you feel like Kevin's evidence?
I agree with that, because why Naomi is asking Ruth to put on her best clothes and wash herself, you know, like presentable and
yes,
kind of be attractive. So to me, she's offering herself to be like a wife.
Yes. Okay. Good. So it sounds like we have some congruence. That's great. Great textual work. You know what? I've been in many Bible studies where people just spout off ideas and thoughts on like what they think the Bible says. But what you guys just experienced in the past minute is like you're looking at the text, you're finding evidence, and that evidence is supporting one option over the other. And that's the beauty of this study, right? So I love that. Okay, so the reason that what Naomi is doing is Naomi is telling Ruth, prepare yourself and reveal yourself to Boaz as a potential partner. And Ruth obeys and goes through and follows through the whole thing. Okay, so let's go through our questions again. We addressed this question. Okay, Kevin, Joseph, and Tamara, could you guys explain your question? Maybe Kevin or Joseph, could you guys explain? I think we may have addressed your question, but is there more to it than that?
Where's Kevin? Oh, Kevin's here.
Oh, you're muted, Kevin.
I think what the question was trying to ask was like, because this is a very, very unique event, the uncovering feet and everything. I think the question was like, is this a normal thing? Or was it something absolutely not? And if this was a normal thing, then if this is a normal thing, then there probably should have been more women.
Okay.
No, yeah. I think Jerome, I think to me, I'm sorry, huh?
No, you're good.
To me, it's not like a normal thing, because you know why? I noticed that Boaz woke up earlier than anybody else because he doesn't want to see it. He doesn't want to know anybody what happened that night. So that's why I think it's not a normal thing that really normally happens traditionally, because he's going to be, it's like he's embarrassed to anybody to know what happened.
Yeah.
So he woke up with anybody ahead of anybody else, and he left.
Yep. That's good. Go ahead, Bob.
esque. I agree. With that, but I think it's only an issue because there's a closer kinsman. Had there not been a closer kinsman, they would have I don't want to use the word consummate. I'm sorry, but they would have been just together, okay? And there's no problem. But imagine if it became known that Naomi had laid down next to him, whether anything happened or not, but just, you know, that whole act of laying at her feet. And then he goes to the next day and someone saw her. And the next day he goes to the kinsman, the closer kinsman, he goes, oh yeah, you know, I need to do that. But there would be a problem because she would be compromised, right?
Rumors, there'll be rumors.
So he was protecting her reputation so that if the closer kinsman had wanted her, then he would not get in the way of that.
Yeah.
Dolores, you were gonna say something?
Yeah, I was asking if it was a custom, because if it was, it appeared that there was no one else at his feet, you know, a servant or whatever. So, like you said, she was obeying her mother-in-law's orders. And I agree with Bob. I think that, and the others, I think she was preparing for marriage. Okay. The clothes, her best clothes, and he was protecting her reputation. I think Boaz was a very nice person. He was leaving extra grain for her, and probably leaving extra for the other people.
Okay.
I don't know. He just sounds like a nice person.
Generous person, yeah, indeed. Let me ask, is there evidence in the text that would point us to the fact that this was a customary thing for a woman to betroth herself at the threshing floor? Because that's essentially the question, right? Was it customary for women to offer themselves in betrothal at the threshing floor? Irene, you were going to say something?
I was going to say that he wanted her not to be seen. So it must be a taboo because no one's supposed to know she's done that.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's in the top of page 7, line 1 and 2. It must not be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. So, yeah.
Okay. So the evidence there is page 7, line 1. Boaz says, it must not be known that the woman came to the threshing floor. If Boaz says that, what does that mean?
It's not customary.
It's not customary, right? It's not customary for women to come and offer themselves in betrothal at the threshing floor. Exactly. Maybe it was customary in other places, but the threshing floor was for threshing. Not for betrothals. I think we can agree on that.
Yes.
But we can also agree that she was offering herself and she was doing something that was atypical, and it stood out, but she was definitely offering herself as a wife to be embraced as next of kin by Boaz.
But she's just being obedient to Naomi.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. Can I ask a follow-up?
Go ahead.
Do we think that the timing of it is significant? Like the fact that Naomi said like to do this on the night of the winnowing?
What do you all think?
Well, I think that timing does have something to do with it because, as you said, the harvest was over, or it was towards the end of the harvest. So Ruth may not have many more opportunities to spend time with Boaz or to stay under his protection.
That's a great observation, right? What are you going to glean when the harvest is over?
Yes, you don't have business anymore to go there because there's no more harvest, right?
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Yeah, unless you plant something else. Like when I pull up all my plants in my backyard here, it's barren. There's nothing that I'm getting from there, and there's nothing happening there, right? So the fact that the harvest was coming meant that Ruth no longer had an excuse to go spend time around Boaz. And it
Naomi
was time to go and act.
Naomi is smart. She is good. Yes, she knows what to
lady.
Do.
She's a smart lady. Good. All right, let's go to the next question. And the next question actually was asked by two different groups. It was on page 6, line 12. So Bob, Nanita, and Annabelle asked this, and the group here, Maisie and Sunny, and who else? I can't remember who else was here. I think, the question is this. Boaz says, he uses the word loyalty on page 12. So he says this last instance of your loyalty is better than your first. So how is her behavior in line next to him seen as an expression of loyalty? Okay, so that's the question. How is this behavior of lying next to him seen as loyalty? What do you say?
And I would also like kind of question too, I think our group talked about is the loyalty to Boaz or is the loyalty to Naomi? Because I initially read it as like, oh, it's a loyalty to Boaz because she put herself under him, but she I think she's continuing Naomi's line.
Well, yeah, I mean, Naomi, but in reality, her loyalty is to her dead husband.
Who's her? When you say her, Bob, who are you referring
Ruth's
to?
Ruth's loyalty is to her dead husband, to Naomi's son.
Yes, okay. Go ahead,
Eddie and I, we were talking about it, and we said it was also like extension to Naomi because now Ruth is watching out for Naomi, the security of Naomi, by doing this, so her loyalty is not just for following Naomi around, it's making sure that she's also secure.
Okay.
I agree with that. I see them one and the same. What I said before encompasses her care and loyalty to Naomi.
And I just want to add on to, in the text it says like, this last instant of your loyalty is better than the first. You have not gone after young men, whether poor or rich. And so when he's talking about young men, poor or rich, the thing that they both have in common, because I was like, why not have Ruth go for a rich other dude, right? You know? But the thing that other young men, poor or rich, that they both have in common is that they are not kinsmen redeemers.
And let me expand on that, Kevin. When you say kinsmen redeemer, just so that we all understand here, what do you mean?
Is the goal. The goal.
The goal, right? Which expand on that a little bit more.
The one that helps continue Naomi's family line in place of Ruth's dead husband.
Yes. Okay, so if you look at here, Elimelech left Bethlehem and went to Moab, right? In Bethlehem, his family name is there. There's property. There may be some rights that are in the family of Elimelech. The moment Elimelech died, that all was handed down to his sons. The moment his sons died, that became frozen. All of the assets of the family of Elimelech became frozen because Naomi could not redeem those things. Ruth could not redeem those things because in those days, the widows did not have rights to get those properties, that all the assets, right? And so if Ruth went after another man, it would have been good for her. But all of the assets and the family line would have been cut off at that point, which is a significant thing, right? the piece of land that they owned and all of that, the family name, that all just sort of ends there. But by holding out and offering yourself to the kinsman redeemer, the potential kinsman redeemer, that is Boaz, it's an opportunity to reclaim all of the line of Elimelech, the assets, the name, all of that. And, you know, here in our American culture, we think of assets as like monetary, but, you know, the family name is not just a monetary thing. It has to do with land and space. Like for me, my parents grew up in India. And in India, our family name, my father's family name, he's from the house of Chittimugut. In the house of Chittimugut, there's a small village in the southwest tip of India where this village is. And in there, if you go to this house, there's a plot of land that my grandfathers, my great-grandfathers, many, many generations of people have owned this land where they train elephants, where they grow rice, where they harvest rubber and coconuts, all this stuff. That's in our family line, and that will, well, it stopped being there the moment my dad moved to the United States. But the assets are so much more than wealth. The assets is the name, it's the land, it's the people group, and once that gets cut off, it seems to disintegrates. And so this loyalty, it's a big thing that Ruth does. Any comments or thoughts just to offer on to that?
One thing that I noted as far as like a theme with Boaz is that he is a, and I mentioned this before, but this is just consistent. He's a man that studies character. Mm-hmm. And he saw, you know, Ruth's character by her reputation when he first met her. You know, that was back a page ago. And then here, by her actions, he knows what she's doing, right? That and he must be older, right? And maybe not that much of a catch, okay? and also, so she had options. So I don't know how attractive she was, but he saw that she had options, right? And so he sees again, and he comments immediately on her character. He reiterates her loyalty and in her first act of loyalty towards Naomi, and then he says, "This is you've topped yourself, right?" And again, I think it's a thing that, you know, this is a love story, right? So I mean, it's so touching to me that he is so attracted to her because he notices the strength of her character.
Yeah, that loyalty. Yep, that's great.
And I think that Boaz got it already that she's throwing herself to him, and Boaz got it. He said, even though the words that he's using is my daughter, and he said, I will do for you all that you ask. So that means he knows the intention.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Did they have to pay like a dowry when they got married?
There's no mention of dowry here in this text. So we're not told that there is. As I've looked up things, there's no mention of it either in the Hebrew culture.
I had a question along those lines, though, that I didn't write down. So this act of being kinsman redeemer, right? So, of course, there is, you take on another wife. That's part of it. And then with the intent of having male children, right? Am I tracking right? Is that, that's what I remember for the reading, I think. And the property, though, I guess it comes under your care, but it's not going to be your property. It's going to be your son's, but it's not going to be into your family. It's going to be separate or something. I don't know. I'm a little confused about that.
Yeah. So just to clarify on that, you know, when someone like Boaz, who is acting as a kinsman redeemer, if this happens, right? If he acts as a kinsman redeemer, he is allowing the line of Elimelech to reclaim the property, the name, the land, all of those things. But it's not like Elimelech can just go and sell that property. It's actually going to be handed down to the son of the kinsman redeemer and the wife who lost her husband, which is Ruth. So he can't just sell it. He is allowing the line of Elimelech to reclaim it, which the line of Elimelech is coming now through Ruth.
So it's not Boaz's to sell.
No, it's not.
So he becomes more like the caretaker of that property.
He becomes the caretaker of that. In the whole scheme of things, this is for Boaz, he will get a wife, but financially it's a loss for him to do this. This is not like a big win for him on a, you know, in the balances of finances. It's a very peculiar cultural thing, but it once we get our mind around it, it starts to make some sense, right?
I want to add just to his character too, like I think just this whole situation is really scandalous, but he's in a position of power, being a man during that time and being really well known by the people with a great reputation. He could have used any bit of his power at any point to do anything scandalous. He could have told her, you know, take advantage of her in that situation, and the town wouldn't believe her because she's a woman and she was a Moabite in that time. Yet in all of that, he not only does he go to great lengths to protect her from any type of like controversy or rumors, even like blesses her mother like with, you know, measures of barley, even though he doesn't know for a fact if he's going to be the kinsman redeemer or not, but he's still looking ahead.
Good. All right, I want to ask the last question. So the last question we had is on page 6, line 14. And it says there that when Boaz is speaking to Ruth, he says, "All the assembly of my people know that you are a worthy woman." How do people know that Ruth is a worthy woman?
That's an interesting question, because when she first came to town, everybody looked at her as the foreigner, right? So she was somebody who couldn't be trusted. The gods that her people worshipped were into human sacrifice. And now we see the whole change where the townspeople say, look at Ruth. She's very worthy. She's somebody who we should respect.
Yeah.
A big change.
Yeah.
So I think everybody would have been watching how she was acting, what she was doing, how she took care of Naomi.
Okay. So what you're saying, Eddie, is like, because of her loyalty to Naomi, her willingness to glean, do all those things, that's a sign of her worthiness. Was somebody going to say somebody else? Was Irene or somebody else?
Even her work ethics. Remember, she was gleaning the whole day. She only had a few sec, you know, she never rested. She ate, she drank, and then she worked again. So even her work ethics, I think, was also noted in some parts of the other, a few lessons ago.
Yeah, that's good. So, you know, people have taken notice, and as Eddie pointed out, this is significant because when she first enters Bethlehem, she's a foreigner. Everybody knows it's Ruth the Moabite. Ruth the Moabite, Ruth the Moabite. She sticks out like a sore thumb. But apparently something has changed. People have taken notice of her loyalty to Naomi. People have taken notice of her work ethic, her willingness to work and to glean for the care of her and her mother-in-law. And none of that has gone unnoticed. It's all been sort of jotted down in the collective memory of people. And they see her as a worthy woman. Excellent. All right. What I want to do is I want to ask this question. You know, when we interpret, when we first start a Bible study, we ask, what do you see? That's observations, right? When we interpret, like we just did, we ask, what does this mean, right? What does he see? What does this mean? And the next question I want to ask is, what does this mean for me? So what does this mean for us? So as a group, and that's called implications. there's a step between interpretation and application, because implication asks the question, what does it mean for me? Application is, what am I going to do about it? Okay, so what does this mean? As you look at this text, at all that happens here at the threshing floor, what are some implications for us? What do you think this means for us? And I will jot some things down in the Google Doc. Yeah, so what does it mean for us? Feel free to just unmute yourself and call out. As you look at these characters, as you look at, Ruth, Naomi, Boaz, like what's something that speaks to you, that maybe God's using to speak to you?
You mean like, judging a race, another person's race?
It could be anything. There's no specific answer. I'm just asking, like, what do you feel like God's speaking to us collectively through the scripture? So it could be. Do you want to expound on that, Dolores, or is there other thoughts?
I think don't make a decision on a person until you actually know that person.
Okay. And that's based on, explain how you see that in the text, Eddie. Just, I think I understand, just so we all understand.
So I think it comes from Ruth coming to town. Everybody made their mind up about what she was like, but by observation, by interaction with her, they ended up having a totally different perspective of her.
Yeah, that's great. Exactly. So don't be quick to make assumptions on a person before you get to know that person.
To me, in my opinion, having a good moral character means a lot, because it speaks for yourself. And we as Christian, we should be very careful on how we walk. So that's what I was thinking, yeah, from these verses.
Yeah, Nanita, when you say character, are you saying that Boaz is an example of character for us, or is it Ruth? Which one are you pointing at?
Actually, Ruth showed a good character on these instances. And it's very important, because with that, Boaz was impressed, right? Otherwise, if she doesn't have those kind of characters, yeah, then how can Boaz be interested to her?
Yeah.
Maybe it's not just the beauty, but also the character, right?
Yeah, no, I agree. That's great. That's a great thing. Let me just expand on that for a moment. I think that there is character that Ruth has. I think we pointed to the fact that Ruth does not act selfishly. She does not act just for herself. She's considering Naomi. And not only is she considering Naomi, Naomi is the one who comes up with the plan. Ruth just executes it. Just decides, I will go through with exactly what you tell me to do, right? But the thing I want to come back to is that our question about, is this normal? So Kevin asked that question. Other folks like, is this customary? And what we said was, this was not customary. So if you put yourself in Ruth's position for a moment, when Naomi tells Ruth, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to the threshing floor, do so-and-so things and do all of that. That cannot be an easy request for Ruth to receive. There's a huge risk involved. Women are not supposed to be at the threshing floor. This is not a normal thing. People do not offer themselves in betrothal to the threshing floor. That's not a normal occurrence. And yet Ruth is willing to overcome what other people think of her. She's willing to take a huge risk, not for herself, but for the sake of Naomi, for the sake of her commitment and her sense of willingness to be tied to her mother-in-law. And so we see a picture of character, but we see also a picture of character that does not care about cultural norms and not care about what other people think, which I think is a powerful image for us. Other folks want to respond? Kevin, you want to say something about that? I see you snapping.
Oh, I was just snapping because I was putting up my amens. I mean, that stuck out to me too, that Ruth takes a really unconventional way, but to serve as the redemption of someone's life. Like, I think in this whole journey with Naomi, she says, like, you know, the Lord has left me and this and that, which has been really difficult for her. But Ruth takes a really unconventional method to do that. And I'm a little bit challenged because sometimes I think in terms of like a box and like, this is how we should do A, B, and C to show God. But like, kind of like what you said, just risking the cultural risk, like breaking certain cultural norms, I think. But to add on to the conversation, I think just simply, the integrity of Boaz, that he had so much power, so much influence in his position, but he never uses his position to take advantage of other people, but he constantly uses it to bless people, even at his own expense, even when he doesn't think that he's going to get anything back from it. And how I see that is, one, it's the whole thing about the Goel marriage. Like, he's technically taking a financial loss by going into this. He maintained his integrity his whole time with Ruth. There's nothing in the text that implies that anything sketchier beyond, and he told her the truth of the other kinsman, the other Goel that could have been a candidate. And last but not least, the fact that he still sent her off with measures of barley for the mother-in-law in event of anything that did not work out in the future, still providing for her, for the family.
Yeah.
So it's a challenging thing to be, I think when I think of him, I think of what Jesus says about, like, if anybody asks you to go like 1 mile, like, you know, go a whole bunch with them, you know. But yeah.
It's good. It's great. Yeah. Boaz is a great picture of what it looks like to wield position and power. That it's very countercultural. It's very much, it's not what we think about typically when we think about position and power. He's giving up his wealth. He's noticing character. I mean, there's things about him that are just, they're profound.
Okay, for me.
Yeah, Sonny.
The way I see the whole thing, what Ruth did is, she did something really right. She has the wisdom. She is compassionate because she doesn't want to leave Naomi alone. Yep. And she was obedient. She's a hard worker. She's loyal. She's a risk taker. And she sacrificed also. And that equals to blessings at the end.
Yeah.
I see. That's the way I see it.
Yeah. Okay. I have two questions for us as we send into application, because the application now is, what are you going to do about it? Or what are we going to do about it? And the first question is this, based off of the picture of Ruth, how does cultural norms or the concerns of other people impact our ability to love our neighbor? Because Ruth is, I mean, she's most literally loving her neighbor, but loving Naomi in a very tangible way. But how does, I should write this down so I don't forget. Sometimes I say things and I forget. So how does how do cultural norms and concerns for other people impact our ability to care for our neighbor? Okay, that's one question. And then the second question I have is off of the picture of Boaz. And that question is this, how is Boaz, some of us are in positions of power and leadership. And how does Boaz instruct you as a leader in a position of power? Okay. How does Boaz instruct you as a person, as a leader in a position? So that may not pertain to everybody, but if it does pertain to you, I'd love for you to interact with that. So again, the two questions are, how do cultural norms and the concerns of other people's thoughts impact our ability to care for our neighbor? And then second, how does Boaz instruct us as leaders in positions of power? Okay. What I want to do is I'm going to go back into our breakout group. So again, as you see, it's going to be the same breakout groups. I know some people had a hard time getting there. Look for the button, press the button. Let's pray to Jesus that it takes us there. And I want you to share in your groups what you think about those two questions. So respond to those two questions. Let's take about 5 minutes. We'll take 8 minutes just to get some time to respond. Okay, let's go.
So let's see which room we end up.
So what group are we, Jerome?
I beg your pardon.
Last time we ended up
wrong. I'm going to put you in group two. How about that? Erna?
Here it is. Okay, Thank you.
Dolores, do you see a button on your screen?
I see you.
There should be a button offering here. Let me move you there. Is your daughter there?
Yeah, Tam.
I'm here. Uh-huh.
Would you mind, Tamara, just I invite her to a room, a breakout room, and she just got to accept it on the
screen.
Here
she comes.
Okay, excellent.
I'm sorry.
I need
is it not working for you? No.
You belong.
Yeah, we got kicked out. So we just signed in back in it.
Okay, can I assign you guys one more time?
Yeah.
Okay, look for the button.
Okay.
Welcome back. Welcome back. I hope I didn't cut anybody off. Hope that was enough time. What I'd like to do is just create some space. How's the Lord speaking to you through this story of what happens at the threshing floor? The image of Ruth and the image of Boaz in particular. How's the Lord speaking to us? Make sure to push space bar to unmute yourself.
Mom, it's unmuted.
So Jerome?
Yeah, go ahead, Eddie.
I'll go first.
Yeah, great.
So one of the things that at work, I lead a group of people. And I think one of the things that came out very clearly to me is that if I'm going to be a person of character, that my character has to shine through in all of my interactions, not with just with the people that I enjoy being with or with family, but for everybody that works with me. And I need to be a leader that's fair and consistent.
Yeah, that's right. That's good.
Okay, I lived in the same house 40 years. Well, I was gone for a few years and then I came back because I sold it to my daughter. And when I got old, I had to come back. So anyway, my cross is the lady across the street. For 40 years, I have tried to get her to go to church, and she won't. And I mean, I have worked on her and worked on her. And I'm not through, but I'm just kind of tired of it. And I don't know why she won't go to church. I'll drive her, and she's a nice person, and she's there for me if I ever need anything. But she just won't go to church. And I think she believes in God, but not maybe the right way. I don't know.
Okay. How is this text bringing her up for you, Dolores? Or why is God bringing up your friend in response to this text this evening?
Well, I feel bad. Because out of all of my years, she's the only one that I've ever invited that has never gone to church.
Mom, what does it have to do with the text tonight that you've discussed earlier?
What?
What does it have to do with the text that you've discussed earlier? Bringing her up. What does that have to do with the text?
Well... It just, I don't know.
Okay. That's an acceptable answer.
It bothers me.
Yeah.
I don't even know why I thought of her.
Okay.
Except Boaz and Ruth and I started thinking of her.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, I there are times when God speaks to us and it has directly to do with the text. Other times it doesn't have to. And you know what? God works in lots of different ways. So whatever reason he's bringing up your friend across the street, that matters. I would pay attention to that. Other folks, other ways that God's speaking to you through this text.
You know, Jerome, you asked a question about Boaz, and Eddie actually responded to it in terms of his leadership, in a leadership capacity.
Yeah.
And And I track with that, but I just see him as now I've had this conversation in the chat room with Kevin. You know, he's just such an example of a person, of a godly person. He's not ashamed to bring God into the equation. He always mentions the Lord in almost every encounter. So you know he's a spiritual man, and he doesn't ever shy away from doing good when there's an opportunity to do good. And so my takeaway is that sometimes I just get too busy, or I'm lazy, or I think I'm going to get to it later, you know, but there's something right in front of me, a person or a situation that, should I reach out to them, or should I do this? And I think there is a scripture somewhere that says, you know, if there's opportunity to do good, do it. And I mean, that's what Boaz did. And he doesn't know how any of this is going to work out for him. He doesn't know if he's going to, you know, there's no, it's just magnanimous. Right. Sure. And God is working through him. I see God working through him to be generous and to be good. And that's the reward right there. And that's what, you know, that's my takeaway. That's how I would like to be more like Boaz.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. Other folks want to respond. Praise God speaking to you.
I think I'm just really drawn to Ruth's loyalty and how, we kind of like talked about it in the larger group of how she could like pursue younger men or other people in the community, but she chooses to act in line with her family and what's beneficial for more than just her. And I think I'm really drawn to that because I think in our current culture, especially when I think about my own career, a lot of voices advise like, oh, just, you know, make the move that's best for you.
Yeah.
And like, there's always like, you know, people to kind of, or jobs to entertain that will like, you know, move up the pay scale, but then is it actually good for like me and my family and even like the team that I currently work for and the leaders that I've chosen to submit to? Yeah. Like, yeah,
that's great.
Yeah, different.
Thanks for sharing that, Maisie. Other folks, other ways that God's speaking to you? Sunny, you were going to say something?
Well, the other comments are similar to mine. So.
Okay, that's fine.
Almost the same.
I saw you unmute, so I thought I'd call on you.
Yeah.
I see unmute as raising your hand.
I am drawn also to Boaz. Was blessed. He was blessed by God. He was in a position to give blessings to others, mm-hmm. and that blessing didn't go to his. He didn't go to be selfish. He didn't go. He didn't get to be power hungry, but he was humble and he had compassion to the people who was put into for him to help. Yeah. Compassion that he showed to Ruth and Naomi, and the understanding for the condition, and you know that we should learn from him that the blessings that we have, we could double it by blessing other people.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. One thing that stands out to me, even this evening as I hear us share, is that there's something about Ruth and Boaz that they are not people or characters who are driven by comfort. Ruth is very much willing to be obedient, and her character is astounding. And she's willing to forego what other people think. She's willing to forego cultural norms. Boaz also, there's costs that he has to pay, but he takes note of people's character. And for him, comfort it's not about making money. It's not about just moving up in the world or what other people think about him. He has other things that he is concerned with, and what the people in the world typically are concerned with. Those aren't the driving forces for Boaz. I think, you know, the word comfort, you know, we often hear like, you know, in churches and Christian circles about being a, you got to get out of your bubble and get out of your comfort zone and whatnot. But that could sort of be a repeated phrase and a repeated theme. I think that particularly as Christians here in America, in the suburbs, we're even if we try not to be comfort driven, we are very driven by comfort. We want comfort. If you look at a lot of the squabbles and the politics and things that come up in churches, a lot of it has to do with comfort. Mm-hmm. A lot of Christian complaints come out of a place of comfort. A friend of mine described it as, you know, we go to church thinking that we want it to be a cruise ship, and we want everybody just to sort of take care of us, and we want the worship music to be exactly the way we want, the speaker to make us feel happy, and we want the whole thing just to, you know, if you think about the cruise ship, like all that the cruise ship is supposed to make you feel, when in reality the church should sort of feel like a battleship, and it should feel like you're getting onto a ship and you're going somewhere, and it's actually not supposed to feel comfortable. And if you don't know the worship song, that's okay. And if you feel challenged that what the pastor said offended you, that might be good for you. But too often we're looking for things that are comforting us. We're looking for things that are just gonna sort of keep us within this certain place. And you look at Boaz and Ruth and you realize these two people, they're the farthest from that. That's just not who they are. That's not who they're wired to be. And, you know, if the fruit of this study is that each of us would begin to live like Ruth, so concerned about other people that we're willing to sacrifice so much of what we are, our own desires, our own longings and all of that kind of stuff for the sake of others. If we were to be like Boaz, to think about all the power and the wealth and the assets and everything that God has given us and think about how can I steward this for the sake of others. I mean, this group here, there's 11 people here, it would have a profound impact in our communities and in our church. The thing I want to say is that it is completely countercultural. To act like Ruth and Boaz is not going to make you a lot of friends. People will speak against you. People will not like what you have to say. But that's part of being in God's kingdom. We're not here just to make lots of friends and have everybody really peachy and happy. So our call is to be disciples of Jesus, and our call is to love our neighbor. And that's it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Erna, would you mind praying for us to close?
Okay.
Okay.
I hope my computer will stay up.
I hope so too.
Loving Heavenly Father, we just praise you and worship you, Lord. What a great time we had tonight to study Boaz and Ruth, what we take out from them. Lord, speak to our hearts, speak to us, and you know our conditions, Lord. You know where we are. And so you may speak to our hearts, Lord, that we might act on the things that we have studied today. You have blessed us so much, Lord. We have, even we are going through this pandemic, this difficulty, but we are still blessed. So we pray, Lord, that we will act on the blessings that you've given us to be a blessing to other people, Lord. We praise you and we worship you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Friends, thanks for giving up a couple hours in your weeknight. Next week is our last study. We will finish the book of Ruth next Wednesday. So be here. Be sure not to miss it. There is an ending to the story. Great. Well, have a great week. We'll see you all next week, yeah?
Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.